So yeah, so in this book I focus on the impact of non-European cultures on the German discourse around 1800. And here is the poem, Aigi Gagit Nimogit Totien Chamiso. And the meaning of it is Ding Gesheten Kokos trinkt, Kokos isst Chamiso. Chamiso drinks and eats peeled coconut. The Marshall Islanders in the South Pacific sound to celebrate the visit of the French-German traveler Adalbert von Chamiso in 1817. Chamiso, a writer with canonical status in German literature, weaves the indigenous lyric and its German translation into a single poem to commemorate the islanders' hospitality. The syllabic and rhythmic similarities, especially with the name Chamiso, tie the two languages together and forge a unified poetic form. The linguistic amalgamation corresponds to the friendly integration of the European Chamiso in Oceania. After traveling around the world as the naturalist on board a Russian expedition ship from 1815 to 1818, Chamiso not only unreservedly expresses his desire to belong to the Marshall Islands, but also acknowledges the intellectual capacities and cultural achievements of the islanders in his travel memoir, Reise die Welt, A Voyage Around the World. He criticizes the Christian mission in the Pacific and suggests that the missionaries should first learn to become like the islanders before embarking on Christianizing them. Chamiso's memoir discloses the instability of his European identity and makes clear the extent of Oceania's impact on his body and subjectivity alike. Indeed, the modest poem profoundly indicates a transcultural progress in which not only does Chamiso have the authorial agency to represent the Pacific Islanders, but the Islanders, through their impact on Chamiso, also actively participate in co-writing Chamiso's memoir. The mutual influence between European and non-European cultures reflected in the German discourse from the 18th to early 19th centuries, and more importantly, the shaping impact of non-European knowledge on German thinking in this period are the focuses of this book. Indeed, the 18th century is a period of tremendous transformations in German and European conceptions of identity and difference, of self and others. I endeavor to delineate the contours of a German transcultural discourse and trace it from 1756, when Immanuel Kant first lectured on physical geography, which he continued to do until 1796 to 1835, the year in which Chamiso published his travel memoir. In German studies and beyond, the 18th century, especially the decades around 1800, is commonly considered the founding era of a German national literature, with Goethe and Schiller as its icons. My book, however, endeavors to highlight the transcultural elements in this historical period. Indeed, the transcultural moments are an indispensable component of the German discourse in the global 18th century. More importantly, an adequate and comprehensive understanding of a transcultural past in German and European intellectual and cultural history pluralizes and subverts a German nationalist tradition that has been unjustifiably used to justify political programs such as Nazism and right-wing extremism in the 20th century and the more recent past. I practice a reading strategy that takes seriously the incongruities or ambiguities in literary and philosophical texts and highlights non-European impact in three representative genres around 1800, travel writings, literature, and philosophical treatises, as I just showed. Engaging with both canonical and popular texts, I choose these authors and genres to provide a broad intellectual and cultural spectrum of the German transcultural discourse around 1800. Within the vibrant field of 18th century post-colonial studies, I'm inspired by the works of literary scholars, historians, and anthropologists such as Srinivas Aramudan, Wendy Laura Belcher, Susan Buck Morse, Greg Deaning, Simon G. Kendi, Robert Markley, Felicity Nussbaum, Mary Louise Pratt, Nicholas Thomas, to name just a few. Primarily focusing on the British, French, and Spanish colonial context in the 18th century, these scholars have exemplarily demonstrated the inextricable and complex entanglement between the 18th century European and non-European cultural and colonial encounters. Yet, unlike France, Britain, and Spain, the German political powers did not have a unified political power and major overseas colonies of their own around 1800. It is true that the Kingdom of Brandenburg-Prussia had several small colonies in Africa and the Caribbean around 1700. For example, Groß Friedrichsburg in today's Ghana, founded in 1683 by the Great Elector, or St. Thomas Island in the Caribbean, leased from the Danish West India Company by Brandenburgische Afrikanische Kompanie for the purpose of slave trade. These colonial sites, however, were soon sold or given up by Brandenburg Prussia in the early 18th century. They were sporadic and short-lived in comparison to the expensive, long-term, and systematic enterprise of British, French, and Spanish colonialisms. Hence, for the period on which this book focuses, the German language representations of non-European cultures do not fully fit the theoretical paradigm of power and knowledge, according to which knowledge production serves the purpose and need of European colonial control, capitalist exploitation, and imperialist expansion. Precisely because of the absence of colony and nation, the pervasive German fascination with non-European cultures urges us to look for other explanations and demands a more refined historical and theoretical discussion. I thus argue that the significance of studying the German transcultural discourse lies in the way it redirects our critical attention toward enhancing the visibility of non-European participation in the construction of the German, European, and globally shared network of knowledge during a crucial period of global modernity. Yet while I stress the differences between the German context and the British and French colonial powers, I also acknowledge the commonalities of German culture within Europe. Despite religious, political, economic, and linguistic variations, a communal sense of belonging existed among European peoples in the 18th century. Technological, economic, and military developments in the 18th century integrated and transformed European powers into one European collectivity with global predominance, though not without internal conflict. Indeed, when Chamisso, Foster, Kotzebue, Campe, Herder, and Kant speak about non-European peoples, their counterpart is always Europe. They barely directly compare Germany with non-European cultures. While they stress German identity within the European context with respect to non-European cultures, they are less concerned with German specificity than with European cultural entity. Hence, being German in the 18th century was not primarily being politically, territorially, or nationally German, as indeed no unified German political authority existed. Instead, being German in the 18th century meant being linguistically, culturally, and intellectually German. Precisely because of the German specificity and similarity within the European community in the 18th century, an examination of German transcultural discourse in the global context will enrich the research agenda of postcolonial approaches to the 18th century, predominantly informed by British and French texts and contexts, and bring to light the non-European participation in and the contribution to European discourses through the German-speaking culture of the age. So I wanted to focus on 2 points. So number one is beyond enlightenment and empire, and then I will introduce the notion I aim to coin in this book, which is transculturality. The first and foremost book-length study to critically engage with the relationship between German discourse and European colonialism in the 18th and 19th centuries is probably Susanna Tantop's path-breaking book Colonial Fantasies, Conquest, Family, and Nation in Pre-Colonial Germany, 1770 to 1870. Drawing on Edward Said's powerful critique of Orientalist representations, Tantop points out the Eurocentric and racist elements and the feeling of superiority toward colonized peoples in German literature and culture. Tantop further interprets this cultural phenomenon before 1871 as Germany's ideological preparation for its colonial enterprises from the late 19th century to the early 20th. Tantop argues that precisely the lack of actual colonies engenders Germans' desire for colonial expansion and fuels their fantasies of material and sexual possession of the New World, in particular South America. Although Zentop's work takes into consideration the lack of a unified German political authority and colonies of its own, her theoretical framework is indebted to the post-colonial criticism based on the French and British colonialisms in the 19th and 20th centuries. Zentop interprets German texts according to a colonizer versus colonized model and reads them as examples of the colonizer's epistemic violence permeating print culture and justifying European cultural and racial superiority and colonial control. Zentop treats the scattered German lands in the 18th century already as a unified political entity with non-European colonies, just like France and Britain. Yet, if we keep in mind that the German fragmentation in the 18th century, then the framework of a proto-national literature in which Zentop situates the German discourse proves problematic. Zentop's argument about Germany's pre-colonial fantasies runs the risk of projecting the later pattern of nation-state onto a past that tells a different story. As Felicity Nussbaum points out, contemporary terms that refer to world connections and divisions often offer anachronistic tools for understanding globality's earlier history. For example, the common modern division between West and East, between Renaissance Italy and the Ottoman Empire, was not a separation immediately recognizable to people living in the 18th century. In the same vein, the conventional framework of national literature originating in 19th century literary criticism projects a national tradition back to the 18th century and limits our understanding of the German discourse in the 18th century. Zentop's argument about pre-colonial imaginations and their colonial and post-colonial repercussions invokes a teleological causation that does not always correspond to the array of variegated historical facts, events, practices, ideas, and their relations. Russell Berman and Sankar Muthu have also recognized the limits of the colonizer versus colonized binary and argue that Enlightenment not only supports the ideology of empire, but also gives rise to the critical spirit that questions empire. Berman stresses the distinctiveness of German colonial experience among the European rivals and draws our attention to the humanist legacy of the Enlightenment. In his book, Enlightenment or Empire, Colonial Discourse in German Culture, Berman reminds us of the dialectic of Enlightenment and comments that contemporary criticism is fraught with tensions deriving from an unresolved evaluation of the legacy of the Enlightenment as being fully complicitous in structures of power and control, including colonialism, or as the only frame available with which credible criticism of power and control can be articulated. He warns that, quote, the dismissal of the Enlightenment legacy entails a sophistry that does a disservice to the human capacity to think about the unknown, to pursue curiosity, and to inquire about the world. Muthu's book, Enlightenment Against Empire, also argues that Enlightenment is not merely about control and subjugation. The contemporary critique of empire is inherently connected to the Enlightenment legacy of humanism, cosmopolitanism, and European self-critique. Berman's and Muthu's counter-arguments are valuable in reminding us of the multivalence of the Enlightenment legacy. In her study on Oceanism in German literature, Stereotype Paradiese, Ozeanismus in der deutschen Südseeliteratur, Gabriele Dürbeck points out the multiplicity and the heterogeneity of genres and topoi stereotypes in the German representations of Oceania. She also considers the colonizer versus colonized model somehow limiting because it does not capture the complex and ambivalent images of Oceania in the German discourse. The concept of stereotype, Dürbeck contends, offers a viable alternative to register not only images of noble savage, but also non-noble savage. The debate over empire or enlightenment, however, has not paid enough attention to non-European agency, which is still largely invisible. Either the critique of Orientalist representations or the insistence on Enlightenment's critical stance inadvertently grants agency almost exclusively to the European colonizers who actively represent the colonized. Whereas non-Europeans are mourned merely as the passive and exploited, colonized. In other words, the Europeans and Germans are recognized as the sole speaking and acting subjects, while the agency of non-European knowledge, as demonstrated in the poem cited at the beginning of this book, remains little recognized. Hence, my approach differs from those of Tantop, Berman, Mutu, and Dubeck. I focus on enhancing the visibility of non-Europeans' impact on the German discourse. This doesn't mean that I could offer a completely different picture of 18th century German discourse. Instead, I aim to introduce a different perspective of reading from the other side, from outside of Europe. This perspective yields different choices of text and different emphasis in arguments. Susan Buck-Morse's essay on the impact of Haitian Revolution on Hegel's conception of master and slave serves as an inspiration for my approach. Last but not least, the participation of non-European cultures in the German discourse should not be and is not confined to the colonial context. The notion of transculturality, I shall argue, offers a theoretically and historically more precise alternative. Moving beyond the binary of empire and enlightenment, transculturality makes visible not only the problematic misrepresentations of non-Europeans, but also the challenges from and the participation of non-European cultures in the German discourse. Transcending the opposition between the colonizers and the colonized, transculturality highlights the non-European contributions within the German discourse. While the Saidian post-colonial critique is inextricably connected to the critique of the European imperialist hegemony in the 19th and 20th centuries, in the 18th century, the order of the global geographical constellation was more polycentric than Europe-centered. Kenneth Pomerantz shows in exemplary fashion in his book, The Great Divergence, China, Europe, and the Making of the Modern World Economy, the European economy in the 18th century had surprising similarities with the East Asian economy, particularly China's. Core regions in China and Japan around 1750, quote, resembles the most advanced parts of Western Europe, combining sophisticated agriculture, commerce, and non-mechanized industry in similar, arguably even more fully realized ways. Recent research has shown that the gross domestic product of China in 1820 was $199 billion, whereas the United States and five European countries, so United Kingdom, France, Germany, Italy, and Austria together had $128. Yet, quote, the fortunate global conjunctures, that is, the European colonial exploitation and the internal difficulties in East Asia contributed to Europe's economic breakthrough in the 19th century and its great divergence from East Asia. Pomerantz argues that Europe could have wound up on an East Asian labor-intensive path if it had not had the colonies. Pomerantz's approach from the perspective of global history and the comparisons between Europe and East Asia in the long 18th century provide refreshing insights into the study of the relationship between European, German, and non-European cultures. This should by no means foster a Sinocentric understanding of the world and undermine or neglect the contributions of other parts of the world. Rather, the example of East Asia serves to highlight the polycentric nature of the global 18th century while not ignoring European colonialism. Against this backdrop, 18th century cultural relations, especially those between Germany and non-European cultures, I argue, should be seen from the prism of a concept that recognizes the contribution of non-European cultures in European and German discourses while not ignoring Eurocentric and condescending elements. I call this concept transculturality. The prefix trans has been widely used in recent theoretical approaches that aim to subvert fixed boundaries and teleological trajectories. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, trans is a Latin proposition meaning across, to, or on the farther side of, beyond, outside. Similarly, Duden defines trans as hindurch, quer durch, hinüber, jenseits, über, hinaus, lokal, temporal, und übertragen. Trans stresses the integrative zones between conceptual and disciplinary categories, such as national literature and culture, and describes new intellectual and cultural concepts and practices It denotes relations and connections between entities and emphasizes the processes of interactions and the integrations of different forces. Concepts such as transnation, transculture, transgender, or transdiscipline describe the encourage new practices and forms of life. The Mexican philosopher Enrique Dussel's concept of transmodernity stresses the concurrence of historical transformations of different regions and cultures in the global context around 1800 and challenges the teleological trajectory from European modernity to postmodernity that does not include contributions from the non-European world. The concept of transmodernity should enhance the visibility of the non-European world in the process of global modernity and offers us a new means of understanding our global history and envisioning our future in a polycentric way. If the prefix trans in transmodernity indicates polycentricity in the 18th century, then the term transculturality is an apt description of the German discourse in which various cultural interactions, mediations, and transformations take place. The notion of culture in German and Western intellectual history is often traced back to Johann Gottfried Herder. Herder's insistence on the uniqueness of language and literature as the key components of an organic cultural tradition called either Volk or Nation had been used to shape German cultural identity since the 18th century. His famous dictum, "Every nation has its own center of happiness, like every ball its own center of gravity," is often cited to justify the incommensurable essence of one particular culture and thus the equal status of all cultures, which is known as Herder's cultural relativism. Yet Herder's cultural relativism, based on the notion of culture as a closed circle and an entity with clear boundaries, is different from my conception of culture as a porous and flexible environment in which different voices and agencies collide, mingle, and transform. My notion of transculturality is thus different from Herder's cultural relativism. Following Herder, we can only talk about interculturality or multiculturalism, but not transculturality. I'll come back to this point later, if I still have the time today. As I will show you in the chapter on Herder, his philosophy of history and his ethics of historical revenge disclose traces of the influence of Native American and other non-European cultures and are themselves transcultural documents par excellence. Indeed, the life stories of all of the authors in this book transcended the German-speaking territorial boundaries in the late 18th century and thus embody transculturality. Chamisso immigrated from France to Berlin with his family during the French Revolution. He later used German as the major language for his literary and scientific writings. Foster lived in different parts of Europe, Prussia, Russia, England, and Poland, and journeyed around the world with James Cook. Kotzebue, born and raised in Weimar, spent almost his entire adulthood in Russian service and lived in today's Latvia for decades. Königsberg, the town in which Herder studied with Kant, was an important seaport frequented by ships traveling around the world. It was also a center of German book fairs, presses, and intellectual life, while the town switched back and forth between Prussian and Russian rule in the 18th century. Hence, transculturality is not a theoretical concept imposed on German discourse. Rather, transculturality describes and summarizes historical circumstances around 1800 that have not been sufficiently emphasized in scholarship. It highlights the integrative moments of cultures and moves beyond their fixed or imagined borders. Even though the notion of transculturality has often been used, as Wolfgang Lösch points out, to describe 21st century human migrations and circulations of cultural products, commerce, and goods, I deem it a historically and conceptually precise and productive notion for the 18th century German discourse in the global context. Thus, I differentiate transculturality from other widely used terms such as transnationalism, interculturality, or multiculturalism. Transnationalism is primarily aims to describe 20th and 21st century supranational movements and communities that subvert national boundaries and construct shared networks of religion, ethnicity, language, and even terrorism. In German studies, transnational approaches have already yielded numerous scholarly work focusing on German culture and history in the global context around 1900. while transnationalism still implies and acknowledges the existence of nation-states as the representative unit of political, cultural, and socio-historical forces. So transculturality better reflects the pervasive German fascinations with non-European cultures and the lack of a central German nation-state in the 18th and early 20th centuries, and thus more precisely acknowledges the German language discourse as that of a cultural community, but not merely as another case providing the power and knowledge paradigm.